Good morning. Welcome to worship. Glad to see you remembered to turn your clocks ahead last night, and so you're here on time. That's a wonderful thing. Today, we are continuing our series, Rethinking Religion, and today, God's Word has us rethinking the solution to sin. It's not about what we do for God. Instead, it's the solution that He has provided for us in our Savior, Jesus Christ. This morning, we'll be following the order of service called Morning Praise as it begins on the bottom of page 45 in the front of the hymnal. We join now in our opening hymn, hymn 108. Please stand. O Lord, open my lips,
and my mouth shall declare your praise.
Hasten to save me, O God. Behold the Lamb of God, let us worship Him.
O come, let us sing to the Lord, let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into His presence with thanksgiving. Let
Praise,
for the Lord is a great God.
Please be seated. Our first lesson is recorded in Numbers chapter 21. The Lord promised a solution for the bite of the poisonous snakes. And that solution perhaps seemed nonsensical. And yet all those who trusted God's promise lived. They traveled from Mount Hor along the route to the Red Sea to go around Edom. But the people grew impatient on the way. They spoke against God and against Moses and said, "Why have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the desert? There is no bread, there is no water, and we detest this miserable food." Then the Lord sent venomous snakes among them. They bit the people, and many Israelites died. The people came to Moses and said, "We sinned when we spoke against the Lord and against you. Pray that the Lord will take the snakes away from us." So Moses prayed for the people. The Lord said to Moses, "Make a snake and put it up on a pole. Anyone who is bitten can look at it and live." So Moses made a bronze snake and put it up on a pole. Then when anyone was bitten by a snake and looked at the bronze snake, he lived. This is the word of the Lord. We join in our psalm for this morning, Psalm 27, on page 75 in the front of the red hymnal. Our second lesson is recorded in Ephesians chapter 2. God's solution to sin is offered by grace and is received through faith. "As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live, when you followed the ways of this world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature objects of wrath, but because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace, expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. This is the word of the Lord. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Please stand for the reading of the gospel. The gospel for the fourth Sunday in Lent is recorded in John chapter 3. Here we see that Christ is the solution to sin. Whoever believes in Christ shall not perish, but have eternal life. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the desert, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but men love darkness instead of light, because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that his deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light, so that it may be seen plainly that what he has done has been done through God. This is the gospel of the Lord. The congregation may be seated. At this time, I invite the children to come forward for the children's message. Good morning. I need your help here. Can anyone tell me what this word says? Close. It says, it looks like disciple. That's definitely in the word. But what is the word? Discipline. Yeah. Now, maybe the harder question. Can anyone tell me what discipline means? Or maybe let me ask it a different way. Let's say on the rare occasion that you do something naughty and you get caught by your parents, what happens to you? You get in trouble. What does that mean when you get in trouble? What happens? Maybe you have to go sit in the timeout chair. You know about that, yeah? A consequence, maybe, yeah. Maybe you go to your room, right? Maybe that's the consequence. You have to go to your room, or maybe you don't have as much screen time that day, right? Because of whatever it was that you had done. Now, you might think your parents enjoy disciplining you, right? That they like seeing you upset, right? But really, we don't, right? Why do our parents discipline us? Because they love us, right? Because they love us. That might be hard for you to understand at this point in your life, but it's because they love you. And they want you to learn that what that bad thing was that you did, that that's not God-pleasing, right? Maybe you could get hurt, and maybe it's just not in line with God's word. Now imagine if for discipline, if your parents decided to discipline you one day by sending you to your room and then letting a poisonous snake go in your room and locking the door. Yeah, I would not be happy with that either. I can't stand looking at snakes through glass, let alone having one in my room, let alone a poisonous one, right? That would be, seems like a pretty harsh punishment, right? But that's what we heard in our first lesson. The Israelites were disobedient. They were naughty. They grumbled and complained against God. They were coming from Egypt to the promised land. They were traveling in the desert for a long time, and they complained to God. They complained about the food. They complained that it was taking so long. And so God said, okay, I'm going to discipline you. And he sent poisonous snakes into the camp, and they bit the Israelites, and many of them died. And so they realized, it taught the Israelites, we're doing something that isn't God-pleasing. And they realized grumbling and complaining against the Lord was not good. And so they came to Moses and said, we sinned when we grumbled and complained against God. Can you pray to God for us? And so Moses prayed to God, and this was the solution that God came up for them. He said, okay, Moses, make a bronze snake and put it on a pole. Then lift up that pole, and when anyone looks at that snake on the pole, if they've been bitten by a poisonous snake, they will be healed. They will live. Now, it wasn't that Moses made some magical snake that had the power to heal them. It was because of God's promise that if you look at that bronze snake, you will live. And the Israelites who were bitten and looked at that snake, they did live. They didn't die. Now, that reminds us of someone else who was lifted up that God tells us to look to in faith. You know who else was lifted up? It wasn't a snake, it was a person. He wasn't lifted up on a pole, he was lifted up on a cross. And who was that? Jesus. Yeah, Jesus was lifted up on a cross. And God tells us that when we sin, we too should look to that cross, look to it in faith, and Jesus heals us of our sin. We will not die eternally because of Jesus. He came and paid for our sins so that when our time on this earth comes to an end, where do we get to go? We get to go to heaven, right? Because of Jesus, because God, in his mercy, took care of our problem of sin. And sometimes God will allow hardships to come into our life, and he uses those to direct us back to the solution, which is our Savior. It's not ourselves, it's Jesus. He paid for our sins, and because of that, we get to look forward to heaven. That's really what Lent is all about, the season of the church year that we're in. Lent is all about Jesus and what he did to take care of that problem of sin for us. So let's go to him in prayer. Let's fold our hands and bow our heads, and we'll pray to God. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for sending your Son Jesus to suffer and die in our place, to forgive our sins so that we can look forward to heaven. Amen. Thank you for coming down. You can go back to your pews. We'll continue with our next hymn, hymn 391.
Thank you.
Cast your cares on the Lord, and he will sustain you. He will never let the righteous fall. Amen. Dear friends in Christ, are we there yet? How much longer? Those of you who have taken a long road trip with children have probably heard those questions before. Those questions come from impatience, from boredom, and perhaps even a little lack of trust that the driver actually knows where they are going. Now, it's even worse when there's more than one child in the vehicle asking that question. If you have two or three impatient children riding in the vehicle, then it really makes for a long road trip. After hours of listening to the complaints, Dad may finally have had enough, and he threatens, "If you don't be quiet right now, I'm going to pull this vehicle over." And often that threat will accomplish the desired quietness, at least for a few hours or a few moments. Now imagine that you had 2 million children, teenagers, and adults all complaining, "Are we there yet? How much longer?" And then you might begin to understand what Moses felt and what the Lord felt. And this was much more than just impatience. This was disrespect. This was a lack of trust. And so we see God punishing the children of Israel by sending venomous snakes into their camp. But this familiar account teaches us much more than don't make God angry or he will punish you. No. What we will see this morning is that with the Lord, even discipline has a loving purpose. The Lord's discipline, which came in the form of these poisonous snakes that were sent into the Israelite camp, led the Israelites to repent of their sin. And the solution that God provided of a bronze snake on a pole foreshadowed the deliverance that God would provide for the poison of sin. Our sermon text for this morning is our first lesson from Numbers chapter 21. They traveled from Mount Hor along the route to the Red Sea to go around Edom, but the people grew impatient on the way. They spoke against God and against Moses and said, "Why have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the desert? There is no bread, there is no water, and we detest this miserable food." Then the Lord sent venomous snakes among them. They bit the people, and many Israelites died. The people came to Moses and said, "We sinned when we spoke against the Lord and against you. Pray that the Lord will take the snakes away from us." So Moses prayed for the people. The Lord said to Moses, "Make a snake and put it up on a pole. Anyone who is bitten can look at it and live." So Moses made a bronze snake and put it up on a pole. Then when anyone was bitten by a snake and looked at the bronze snake, he lived. This is God's word. In a way, I think we can sympathize with the children of Israel and their impatient feelings here. It wasn't that they were in a car for 8 or 9 hours. It wasn't that they were traveling on a road trip for 3 or 4 days. No, they had been on the road for 40 years. 40 years. A journey that should have only taken them a few months turned into decades because of the unbelief and the rebellion of the Israelites. And so understandably, they were getting tired of this journey. And then finally, they were approaching the land of Canaan. They were almost there. They just had to go through the land of the Edomites and they would finally be home. But the Edomites refused to let the nation of Israel travel through their land. And so the Israelites had to go down another way. Already having been on a long trek, now they had to go even further through a remote, desolate area that had extremely high temperatures and a number of poisonous snakes. And so can you blame them for being a little cranky? A little impatient. And what would we have done if we were in their situation? Something else that only added to the Israelites' list of complaints was the food. Day after day, week after week, month after month, year after year, for 40 years they ate the exact same food. If it was you or me eating the same thing, we probably would complain too, wouldn't we? We'd probably start complaining after eating the same thing for only a week. And again, they ate the same food for 40 years. Now, the Lord had miraculously provided manna during the morning and quail in the evening for the Israelites to eat. They never had to worry where their next meal would come from. And yet they complained to God. Our text records their whining and complaining. Why have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the desert? There is no bread, there is no water, and we detest this miserable food. Now just imagine for a moment that you are God. And you have been feeding for free 2 million people so that they have something to eat every day for 40 years. And now they think that's not good enough. How would you feel if you were God? Well, God was certainly upset and saddened by the ingratitude of the Israelites. He was also angry. And yet, amazingly, the Lord also had feelings of love towards these people who were rejecting him. He wanted to find a way to get them to appreciate him and his love for them. And sending these snakes into their camp was the solution that God provided. Now, it's fair to say that we sometimes sadden God and anger him by our impatience. I mean, who of us likes waiting, right? We don't like waiting to find a new job or waiting to get over an illness. Waiting, waiting, waiting. It seems like that's all that we do. If you're like me, you probably aren't very patient. We might even get to the point where we say to God, are we there yet? How much longer? And yet so often in our lives, the Lord calls on us to be patient, to wait, and to trust that he is going to take care of us. And like the Israelites, we sometimes sadden God and we anger God by our lack of appreciation for his gifts to us. God has given us a home to live in, and yet when we see the bigger home that other people are living in, we want what they have. Or God has provided us with a vehicle, which is a real blessing, so that we don't have to walk or ride a bike or take a bus to get to work. And yet that vehicle just isn't quite as nice as we would like it to be. Or the Lord gives you a loving spouse, and yet you lust after other people. When we do things like this, we are basically saying to God, you know what? We detest this miserable food that you have given us, God. And just like the Israelites, sometimes the Lord will send something into our lives to shake us up a bit. And again, these are good things because they lead us to turn around. They get us refocused on what is really important. Yes, hardships can help us realize the many blessings that the Lord has already given to us. Now, to discipline the Israelites, God used an existing danger that was there in the desert. He caused the poisonous snakes in that region to go into the Israelite camp and to bite the people, resulting in the death of many of the Israelites. But as we will see, this account isn't so much about God punishing the Israelites as it is about God providing an escape from the punishment, a solution for sin. After a number of Israelites had been bitten by the snake, they suddenly realized how they had been acting, and they came to Moses and they confessed, "We sinned when we spoke against the Lord and against you. Pray that the Lord will take the snakes away from us." Moses prayed on behalf of the Israelites, and the Lord in his mercy told Moses what to do. And it really was pretty simple. Moses made a snake out of bronze metal. He placed that snake up on a pole that probably had a crossbeam to hold up that snake. And then he instructed the people that if they were bitten by a snake, that they should look to that bronze snake. And if you looked at that bronze snake on the pole, you wouldn't die. Now, it wasn't that Moses made some magical snake that had the ability to heal the people. No, it was God's promise connected to that bronze snake that healed the people when they were bitten. And the reason that this Old Testament reading is included in the pericope for the fourth Sunday in Lent is because the bronze snake and the deliverance that it brought the Israelites from those poisonous snakes foreshadowed the deliverance that our Savior would bring. 1,500 years later, another being would be lifted up on a pole and promised deliverance from the poison of sin that is coursing through our veins. Yes, Jesus Christ would be lifted up on a cross, and whoever looked to Jesus in faith would live. Jesus himself made that connection in our gospel today when he said, "Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the desert, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life." This is really where the account of the bronze snake hits close to home for us as Christians. Today, God's word has us rethinking the solution to sin. It isn't about being better or trying harder. We don't have a prescribed number of rules and laws that we have to keep or follow. No, to get to heaven, we simply look with our eyes of faith to the cross. And as we look to the cross, we see God's solution to the poison of sin. We see our Savior who suffered and died to pay for the sins of the whole world. Jesus carried our impatience, our lack of trust, our immorality, our selfishness and greed. He carried all those sins with him to the cross. And there he suffered the hell those sins deserved in our place. And even though we still struggle with sin right now, whenever we give into that sin, whenever we fall short of living the way that our holy God demands of us, we can turn to our Savior in repentance and believe God's promise that Jesus has removed our sin from us as far as the east is from the west. That is how much God loved us. And that is the reason why we can look forward to eternal life in heaven. Now, God could have certainly punished the Israelites in some other way when they grumbled and complained against him in the desert. But there was a reason that God disciplined them the way he did. His discipline had a loving purpose. It led the Israelites to see their sin and to trust in God for forgiveness and healing. And it also pointed them ahead to their Savior and his cross. And so during this Lenten season, and really every day of our lives, may we also see the love of God on full display. See your sin nailed to the cross. Look to the cross through the eyes of faith and live. Amen. Please stand. The peace of God, which surpasses all our understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. We join to confess our faith by singing, "We Praise You, O God," which is found on page 48 in the front of the hymn.
Spread.
Please be seated as we gather our offerings. Please stand. We continue with "The Lord Have Mercy" on the top of page 50 in the front of the hymn.
In the morning, O Lord, I call to you. Be merciful to me and hear my prayer. O Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. O Lord, have mercy.
We join in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. O Heavenly Father, we thank you for the love with which you loved us, for you did not spare your only begotten Son, but delivered him upon the cross for our sins. You were pleased even to forsake him for a time, so that he might suffer hell for us. To establish your everlasting friendship with us, you made him whom you declared to be your beloved Son, the object of your rejection. We ask you then, for Jesus' sake, not to be hostile toward us because of our sin, but be at peace. Oh, forgive us for the sake of his innocent suffering and death. And as once you sent your Son to be our Savior, send him to reign in our hearts through faith. O Holy Spirit, beloved author of our faith, call to our remembrance the sacrifice that Christ made for us, lest failing to remember we fall into unbelief and all manner of sin. Open our mouths to bear witness to our Savior's name. Open our hearts to give generously to the cause of Christian missions and to the relief of those who suffer want. Let the joy of our salvation in Christ fill our hearts and our minds until that day we rejoice to meet him in glory. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, our God of mercy and love, we commend to your special care all who are afflicted, all who need your help and encouragement, and all who need your healing. Provide for all your children according to their individual needs. We praise your name now and forever, O true and only God. In Jesus' name, amen. This morning we also pray for Paul Goodridge, whose health has been rapidly declining and is near death. We also pray for Frank Norris, who has been dealing with a host of health challenges over the past few weeks. We pray. Almighty God, look with favor on Paul Goodridge, whom you made your own child in baptism. Comfort him with the promise of life with all your believers in your eternal kingdom, the promise made sure by the death and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Almighty and everlasting God, you have promised us forgiveness of sin and deliverance from eternal death. Strengthen us, we pray, by your Holy Spirit, that our trust in Christ Jesus may daily increase, and that with sure confidence we may hold fast the blessed hope that we shall not die, but only sleep, and at the last day be raised to everlasting life through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. Heavenly Father, giver of life and health, comfort and relieve your servant, Frank Norris, and give your power of healing to those who minister to his needs, that he may be strengthened in his weakness and have confidence in your loving care. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. We continue with our next hymn, hymn 345.
Time.
Please stand for prayer. O Lord, our Heavenly Father, almighty and everlasting God, you have brought us safely to this new day. Defend us with your mighty power, and grant that this day we neither fall into sin nor run into any kind of danger. And in all we do, direct us to what is right in your sight, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord.
Let us praise the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Please be seated. Good morning once again. I'm glad you could join us for worship this morning. Just a reminder that we have Bible class in Sunday school this morning. In our Bible class, we will be starting a new study looking at heaven and hell. Also a reminder that there is a sign-up sheet for Easter flowers next to the flower calendar just outside the church office. Those flowers will be on display during our Easter service, and then you are encouraged to take them home after our Easter Sunday services. Also a reminder, you can still sign up for the Easter breakfast. There are still items that are needed. Your help is needed as well. As you see on the sign-up sheet, In 2 weeks, right, yeah, 2 weeks, on Palm Sunday after the service, after Bible class and Sunday school is done, we will be setting up for Easter Sunday, so that way you don't have to make another trip back in, and hopefully we will have plenty of hands to help with that. So that's on Palm Sunday, if you're able to help with that. And as we look ahead to Easter Sunday too, please make sure to invite your friends and neighbors to join us for our Easter service at 9:30. You can also invite them to join us for our breakfast starting at 8 o'clock. And the Easter egg hunt, thank you, which will take place during that time as well. It'll probably be a chance to eat, and then after that, the kids will have the opportunity to do an Easter egg hunt. No matter what the weather's like, right, we're going to tough it out. I'm sure they'll be eager to get those eggs. So plan to join us on that day as we celebrate our Savior's victory over sin in the grave. Lord's blessings on the rest of your week.